The other thing that it brings in is the opportunity for us to develop space hotels and orbital tourism. A few orbital tourists have gone up already, and space hotels will happen regardless of a single-stage space plane. But the single-stage space plane allows us to have a much larger number of people go up, and thus we can build much larger space hotels. And in fact, you can see one over there in Virgin Liverpool. I don't know who painted it or not, but there's a slight problem in that anything that's coming back through the Earth's atmosphere will get very, very toasty. So in fact, if you paint it, you know, that paint will come off within one flight. So in reality, the vehicle will remain black, because I'm often asked, why is the vehicle black? Well, it's going to end up black when it comes back through the entry anyway. So the point was painting it. This, on this side, these are inflatable modules, similar to the ones I showed you in the previous slide, but it gives you an idea of how you can build up a decent-sized inflatable space hotel structure very, very easily. And this is all the type of thing that we're going to get to within the next 10 or 20 years. The hotels will come within the next 10 years. The large wheel-style stations will come within the next 20 years. Now, if you talk to most people in the space industry, they'll say, oh, no, no, it's a long way off. But what they're missing is this disruptive technology of the spaceflight, which will change the whole game. The other thing that you get to do when you've got a space plane is cheaply build space power satellites. At the moment, they're prohibitively expensive because you've got to orbit all the bits on expensive rockets. But going up on a space plane, it's going to get an awful lot cheaper. So we'll be able to build those and beam down power. Manned interplanetary spacecraft are going to be a lot easier to build. The upper one here shows a Mars spacecraft, and the lower ones, which are hot off the press from NASA, are ideas for asteroid exploration vehicles. Now, lunar planetary bases, tourism and colonies, they're a little bit further off. We're probably talking about 30 years or so. Now, the one problem I've had with all these is the structures, which is why I was interested in listening to the talk this morning about growing structures. Because a lot of these things look fairly sedate. They're cans. They're boring. If I want to go to Mars and want to go skiing on one of the volcanoes, I want to stay somewhere that's large, that's expansive. I don't want to live in a can. So I think there's a lot of potential there, and we need to bring the world of architecture in with these type of developments. Where next? In space colonies, a little bit further off, as are asteroid colonies and so on. We're probably talking about 40 or 50 years for these, because it's going to take time for the other things to settle first. Space elevators, certainly by the end of this century, it should be possible to build space elevators. They're actually testing some elements of space elevators now on a very small scale. So I suspect we will be able to get there by the end of this century. And that's without a singularity or nanotechnology in a big way. Beyond that, interstellar missions. The first work was done on that back in the 60s with Project Orion, and then in the 70s, it went on with the Project Daedalus nuclear pulse vehicle, which was probably the most detailed interstellar mission ever examined. That's now being followed up with the British Interplanetary Society and the Tor Zero Foundation, who are looking at Project Icarus, which is a follow-on to the Daedalus star probe. So you'll probably hear more about that in the media in the next 4 or 5 years. And post-singularity, assuming a technological singularity occurs, that's when things get really interesting. But this is something that I'd leave as an exercise to you guys when you're living for 200, 500 years. It gives you something to do. But we can start looking at planetary surface architecture, terraforming planets, ring worlds, Dyson spheres, planetary engineering, grow your own planet, essentially. And that's not actually such a wild speculative theory. There are ways of doing that. Jupiter braids, where every atom in a planet is used for computational capability, and stellar engineering, grow your own star. I don't know how to do that last one, by the way, but again, I leave it as an exercise for you. And that's basically it. I've raced through everything because there's so much to cover. So hopefully I've given you a flavour of what we've got coming over the next 20, 30 and even 1,000 years.
Thank you very much.